We're now going to have a question and answer session. We do have a live microphone here for the journalists present. So when you do ask your question, please give your name and identify your news outlet. And who would like to go first? There must be a question here somewhere. I think I'm seeing a hesitant. Yes, is that you? Okay. And here comes the microphone. Please go ahead. I think you're being heard.
All right. Hello?
Yes, please go ahead.
It's for the TV camera.
Oh, I see. this is Ahmed Hazim from RT Arabic. Can I have a question for Mr. John?
Yes, sir.
And my question is regarding that Assad is the only one person standing between Christians and aviation. As you mentioned, but I'm from the region, I'm from there, and Christians have been living there for centuries now, well, more than 2,000 years ago. Actually, Christianity has been created there. Why do you think that only now we are facing aviation? Why they didn't face it before? They survived more horrible rulers than Assad.
Oh, yeah. I don't disagree with you. I think that Christianity has done very well in Syria under Assad. His politics aside, I'm not necessarily a fan of Bashar al-Assad. I think that he's a dictator. I think he's an anti-democrat. But the truth is that with the players that are on the field now, he's the one that gives the Christians the best chance of having a thriving community. If you look at the alternatives, never minding the notion that the United States promotes that somehow magically this is all going to come together and everybody's going to live in peace and harmony, that's just simply not going to happen. So what are the alternatives? The alternatives are ISIS or the Nusra Front or some Al-Qaeda related organization. Or Assad. And of those choices, I think those are the realistic choices, of those choices, the best is Assad. Now, time was, maybe as recently as 2012 or 2013, where there was talk of perhaps a Syrian military junta pushing Assad aside. There was the same talk in Iraq through the 1990s that the best and the most likely alternative to Saddam Hussein was a group of Iraqi of Sunni Iraqi generals. It hasn't happened. And so of the choices that I think the community is facing now, their best bet is with Assad.
Follow-up question very quickly. I have to hold that for the cameras too. And I guess... but the Syrian conflict, the Syrian crisis, have been now more than 6 years, and it's much more complicated
to look at it from one perspective or one angle, mm-hmm. which is minorities, which is
sure.
a very, very serious one, though. But killings have been the headline of any community, majority or minority. So. How I can justify, for example, for the Sunnis, that your killing in Homs and Hama and Hala and all that was to preserve the Christian community?
Oh,
this
well,
is
I think...
just one more.
Sure.
This argument for them.
Sure.
For them will be so unfair.
You're exactly right. And I think you're misunderstanding my comments.
My comments were aimed at neoconservative and neoliberal Democrats and Republicans in Washington who think that anybody is better than Assad, that Assad is the problem in Syria, that we cannot achieve peace with Assad still in power in Syria. It was to them that I was directing my comments. You're exactly right. You can't go to the Sunni community and say that the deaths in their community are less important than in any other community. Same in the Kurdish community. I don't think that any deaths are any less important than any others. It's just that my comments were really geared toward Capitol Hill more than anything else.
Hey. Yes. Oh, sorry, wait for the mic if you would, thank you.
Okay, my name is Priya Reddy from RT America News. Thank you all for your very powerful and thoughtful comments this morning. Regarding the mixed motives that were mentioned that compromised the legal basis for the U.S. interventionism in Syria, you mentioned a couple of arguments that undermine the claim of humanitarian intervention, such as regime change goals and fighting ISIS, perhaps. I wanted to ask, would you or any of you consider the U.S. Allyship or partnership with Saudi Arabia, sort of a notorious human rights abuser, but with regard to Syria, as also something that might undermine the humanitarian motive claim? So that's one question. And the other one was, does the removal of Assad, if that were to happen, a lot of people have expressed fears of seeing another Libya or an Iraq or a vacuum that could be filled with people worse than Assad. Is that something that you could speak to? Or, thanks.
I hope others will answer the questions as well. These are good questions, but I would just point out that when the U.S. participates in war in Yemen in partnership with Saudi Arabia, it violates not only the U.N. Charter and the Kellogg-Briand Pact, but also the U.S. law called the Leahy Law, which says you can only support another nation in mass murder when that other nation does not violate human rights. And how you conduct mass murder without violating human rights, I'm not a lawyer, so I can't answer that for you, but that is an additional way in which U.S. operations in Yemen are illegal. On top of which, you get into this question in Yemen of, well, can an exiled dictator create legality by inviting other nations to attack his country, right? So when Donald Trump is impeached and removed and living on his private island and he invites China to bomb Washington, D.C., I mean, we would all accept that as legitimate, right? No, it's nonsense. These are nonsense arguments for war, just as the argument for Russia's actions in Syria being legalized by the Syrian government. There is nothing in the UN Charter or the Kellogg-Briand Pact or any basic understanding of morality that says war is okay if a dictator asks you to help with it. The U.S. is committing a crime in Syria, so is Russia.
Well, I think certainly, yeah, your concerns about the removal of Assad and in the vacuum, you've certainly seen that in Libya, other locations. As far as relationship of the United States to Saudi Arabia, oh yeah, the hypocrisy is there's lots of slang I can use back from, I'm from New Jersey, there's lots of slang and curses I could throw at you to describe that type of level of hypocrisy. I mean, we provide the fuel and the bombs, the intelligence that allows Saudi Arabia to commit those atrocities in Yemen, let alone what Saudi Arabia is like anyhow in terms of its own internal human rights violations. Lots been made in the last week of the attacks on, and excuse me, but I can't recall the name of the city that Saudi Arabia's Medea, do you know? That's Saudi Arabia's attacking internally. But hypocrisy has always been first and foremost in American, I mean, come on, you go back to the American Constitution. You mean, equality was only for white male property owners. You know what I mean? That's what freedom was meant. So, I mean, there's never been, I mean, this real standard of non-hypocrisy in American speech and thought and political, you know, ideology anyway. So there's always been hypocrisy in everything America has done. And so this notion of talking about Syria, but then coordinating with Saudi Arabia, I mean, particularly too, with you know, going back to, it was brought up before about this notion of sabotaging efforts in 2012 in Syria. I mean, that's about the same time too that we were utilizing via Turkey, Qatar, and Saudi Arabia, their efforts with groups such as Nusra and the Islamic State to try and overthrow the Assad government. You know, the notion that we could try and use those groups for our purposes in Syria while trying to keep them at bay within Iraq. You know, I mean, this is how the United States government operates. And we know all this because of declassified Defense Intelligence Agency reports. So not only are we hypocritical, but we're also bipolar in many ways, because we think we can not just be two-faced, but we think we can also manage certain situations in a way that just defies reality. And of course, coming back at all, it's the very people who live in these places who are being burned to death and ripped apart. And I think it's very easy for us to forget that as we talk about this, as I stand here in my suit and tie, you know, and drink my cup of coffee and everything, that as we speak about this, American bombs are ripping apart men, women, and children as we speak. So it's not abstract at all. Yeah.
I'm sorry, just the number of people mentioned that reliance on airstrikes is a big part of U.S. strategy. Would that also not undermine, will the resulting war crimes not undermine the humanitarian pretext argument as well? That was the final part of my question I left out.
Well, absolutely. I mean, the other thing, too, is I recall there being a report that was released by the United Nations last fall, and I was reminded of this yesterday by a colleague about our sanctions on Syria. And the United Nations reported that our sanctions on Syria and the EU sanctions on Syria, the effect it has on the Syrian population and how deadly those sanctions are, because those sanctions prevent the pharmaceuticals, the medical supplies, the foodstuffs, the things that people need to survive, let alone the things that hospitals need, the things that, I mean, so yes, this notion that we are somehow involved for humanitarian means, but that's all nonsense. I mean, you don't have to look much farther than go back a couple weeks to the Washington Post, where Michael Vickers, who has been in the CIA and the Department of Defense for a long time, he was involved in he was very much involved in the American efforts in Afghanistan in the 1980s against the Soviet Union. But very clearly in that op-ed that the Washington Post ran, he states that in Syria, in the Syrian civil war, we saw an opposition to strike a blow against Iran by removing Assad to cut off Iran's relationship with Hezbollah. I mean, so this is a very senior American official who's been in both Republican and Democratic administrations. They may talk about humanitarian reasons, but for many, many, many people in the national security positions in Washington, D.C., as well as politicians, what they do, what they see, and I've seen this, I was fortunate to be in senior positions in Washington, D.C., in both the State Department and in the Pentagon, for many of these people, it is like a game of Risk. They look at the map and they want to turn different countries the colors they want to turn them. And you can see that in Vickers' column in the Washington Post from a couple weeks ago. Very clearly, they want to turn different colors, different countries, different shades. And that's how these people view the world and how they view it. There's anything they say about humanitarian reasons, that's just good PR. That's just a smart way to address it, a smart thing to say. Yeah.
I just also wanted to address some of the legal frameworks that apply here. So when we talk about human rights law, the right to life, which is embodied in the UN Charter and every human rights treaty basically created, the right to life is inviolable. You know, it's one of the major themes of human rights law. Now, when we're talking about international humanitarian law, which is what governs how war is conducted, whether or not the war was illegal to begin with, or how we got into the war, whether those circumstances were correct or not, in international humanitarian law, there are humanitarian principles that do apply. So, although the right to life under human rights law is the norm and the standard, it is allowable under international humanitarian law to kill, and to even kill, you cannot target civilians, but civilian deaths are allowable. Now, in order for civilian deaths to be allowable, there has to be a very, very strict analysis of distinction, proportionality, military necessity, and so there's this calculus that goes on. What's your military objective, and can you achieve that military objective, and can you achieve it with the least amount of civilian deaths possible? And so that's what military commanders are responsible to do every time they commit any military action. Now, if they have other justifications besides military necessities, such as humanity, that's also absolutely necessary. But what we're looking at, and what many organizations are looking at, is the United States and any other actor that's acting in this context, are they doing everything that they possibly can to eliminate completely or to cause the fewest amount of deaths in any action that they take? So I hope that answers your question.
We have a few more minutes for questions. Yes, please, go ahead.
By default, I have the microphone.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Jafar Jafari. I'm with the Mayadeen TV network. I truly enjoyed the presentations, and I commend the panel for focusing on the military aspect of the U.S. strategy in the Middle East. I believe the narrative should be refocused on the entire U.S. strategy in the Middle East, per se, and that is it's engendered in regime change. Now, only last week, Secretary Tillerson in front of the State Department and clearly stated that the U.S. is no longer seeking regime change in North Korea. Well, if that is true, that is truly commendable. However, if it's okay in North Korea to maintain current regimes, but it's not okay to maintain the current regime in Syria, why should it be the U.S. business anyway to change regimes? And I think this is the narrative that people are looking for. It's not just the aspect of the defined policy, which is implemented through war in the Middle East, whether it's Syria, whether it's in Iraq, Afghanistan, or other areas. But it's the U.S. policy of regime change that has brought us to, you know, through several conflicts to this stage. Thank you.
Well, I very briefly, I agree with you 1,000%. No one has given the U.S. legal authority to decide the fate of other nations by any means. And since World War II, the United States has interfered, as we know, in at least 82 foreign elections, though not in the bad Russian way, presumably, and bombed over 30 countries. You know, this is, no one appointed the U.S. to this role. This is not illegal. This is not enforcing law. This is violating law. And so it has to end. And the U.S. public is not the driving force here. And the U.S. public put Donald Trump in the White House after he campaigned against this practice and said, we're done with overthrowing governments. And to whatever extent he starts to actually abide by that, so much the better. But it ought to become unacceptable in the U.S. To continue down that road. And I would just add that when this discussion of killing as few people as possible in the process, when the United States military says bombing that spot where ISIS stores its money is worth up to 50 civilian deaths, that's not actually fewest possible. That's naming a pretty large number. And there's nothing whatsoever empirical about it. I can't go back and say, well, I studied and it's actually only 45 civilian deaths. No, it's actually 308 civilian deaths. It's not empirical. It's just rhetoric. And it's immoral and it's illegal. And the world didn't ask for it. And the Pew study last week of 38 countries found that the majority of them viewed the United States more than Russia and more than China as the biggest threat, you know, including places like Turkey and South Korea and Japan. And a Gallup poll of a few years back had the similar results. The U.S. the biggest threat of any country to peace in the world. So the global policing is not appreciated by the people being policed, and it ought to end.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. Please identify yourself and with your question. Thank you.
For you. My first question is, yes, wars are bad. Wars are killing people. And you don't want the U.S. To intervene in other countries' domestic policy. Okay, but Syria is like a chessboard. And wars are reality. And the international relations are another reality. And if one day U.S. Takes its aircraft from Syria, don't you think that the United States will lose its ground in Syria about international policy or international relations and leave the space to Russia, to Iran, and to the other powers?
That's a hard question. But I'll preface this by saying that I'm not an attorney. You are, but I'm not. But it's my understanding that legally, if the internationally recognized government of Syria invites another country to come and help it, that other country is there legally. The Russians have been invited by the Syrian government. The United States has not been invited by the Syrian government. Now, I'm all for humanitarian assistance. If we can provide medicine or humanitarian relief, food, water, even safe passage out of the country for refugees, that's great. But it's my understanding that anything more than that, at least at this point in Syria, is illegal. You know, we're supposed to be a nation of laws in this country. We like to tell people, we like to tell other countries that we're this shining beacon of respect for human rights and civil liberties and the rule of law and democracy, and it's just simply not true. It's rhetoric, it's propaganda. So if we were serious about this being true, we would live that policy, and we don't. We just want other countries to live it.
But do you think that if U.S. takes its aircraft from Syria, do you think that Russia and Iran takes their soldiers from Syria also?
Oh, no, I don't think so at all, no. Realpolitik is real, but no, I don't think so at all. I'm not sure that that's really, though, the most important thing to worry about in this scenario. I think that there are bigger issues of respect for human rights and respect for human rights and civil liberties and peace in the region.
And do you want to add something on this issue as a former State Department?
The way I look at it is this. Look, the United States has been heavily involved in the Middle East for seven decades now. About 5 or 6 years ago, Princeton University did a survey or a study They found that since Jimmy Carter's presidency, the United States had spent $10 trillion policing the Persian Gulf region. And I would say that in my lifetime, nearly every country from the edge of the Mediterranean Sea through Afghanistan, with the exception, no, that's not true, including Iran, has been destroyed. Every city has been razed to the ground, more or less, in my lifetime. I was born in 1973. And that's with the United States having spent $10 trillion in the region, having had a massive military presence. I see no reason why the United States should remain in the world in that region. It has provided no help to anybody in the region and has wasted vast amounts of sums of American money, wasted, and millions of people are dead. So I see no value in it. And I can't see any explanation for how or any reason for how things would have been better, or I'm sorry, how things would have been worse if we had not been there. So that's my way I view it. As far as whether or not if the we're not there, if the Iranians are there, or the Russians are there, or the Chinese are there, or the Portuguese are there, or the Finnish are there, or I don't know, that speculation. All I know is what has occurred and what is occurring. And I know that the American military is responsible for so much of it. And that's where that's how I view it.
Unfortunately out of time. I know many of the all the speakers are available to talk one-on-one with the journalists here. I'd like to thank everyone for participating and attending today, and to emphasize that the petition campaign called No U.S. Warplanes Over Syria is continuing. Anyone can sign and participate and be part of the national campaign by going to the web, by visiting rootsaction.org. That's rootsaction.org. And I'd like to acknowledge and thank all six organizations who've made this a nationwide and really international campaign. Rootsaction.org, Veterans for Peace, Daily Kos, The Nation Magazine, Watchdog.net, and World Beyond War. Thank you all for being here.